Welcome to The Human Affair, a low-key profile of people and the ever-changing world around them. In this program, we'll share interesting thoughts, discussions, and experiences that we think you'll enjoy. Now, here's your host, Dr. Wilbur Blume, Professor of International Relations, United States International University.
Hello, I'm Bill Blume. My guest today is Professor Eugene Ray from San Diego State University and an architect. Professor Ray, San Diego Union did a very nice coverage of you here a short time ago in which they used a nice play on words and said that you were a piercing ray of the future.
Well, that was very nice indeed. I'm somewhat embarrassed by that article, but Carol Oaten, who wrote that, worked very hard on it, and she really did a beautiful job in terms of information, I must say. I'm honored by it, actually.
But your interest in architecture is also in more of the future and directions we're moving.
That's correct, Dr. Blume. It occurs to me that we're here on the spaceship Earth, as Buckminster Fuller suggested. Yes. We're moving rapidly through time and space. And truthfully, as we build in this natural environment, this magnificent environment, we haven't kept up with possibilities. And we at the university should be at the cutting edge of better ways to build. So we devote most of our time to these thoughts.
Well, I know the audience is going to want to hear more about this, but we have to take out a brief moment for our sponsors. And so after this commercial, we'll be right back.
The Human Affair is a presentation of KU.
Professor Ray, the article here makes a comparison between you and Buckminster Fuller, who was called the friendly genius of the planet, and the author here uses some words almost that nice about you, describes you as an architect, inventor, engineer, environmental designer, elucidator of the future.
Well, I must say, she really did honor me with all of that. I never thought of myself as any heroic figure, just a man trying to do the best he can with the material he's working with. The truth of the matter is, Buckminster Fuller was a person who introduced me and many others to more important ways to build physical environment. It's interesting that he wrote the introduction to a book on Alexander Graham Bell, who was working with lightweight systems in the last century. There are a number of people like Buckminster Fuller that have been aware of natural systems that could be applied to construction that we architects were not given the information about in the past as we should.
Well, in your work at San Diego State University, you refer to it as environmental design.
That's correct.
What is the difference between architecture and environmental design?
Be honest with you, I had not heard of environmental design before I came to California, but at that time, 1969, some wonderful things happened to me and this world of ours, in that the Pulitzer Prize was awarded to the Whole Earth Catalog, and the symbol of the Earth on that cover of
the
that
big blue marble,
that big beautiful picture of the Earth, became the symbol for me of what environmental design is. And it is an attempt to build physical environment that does justice and graces the Earth. We had not done that in the past. I'd say that 95% of what we build is not gracing the Earth. So our dedication is to that symbol and what it stands for.
So would it be accurate to say you're interested in a more holistic concept of design?
That's exactly correct.
As opposed to making a building?
That's true. I think the social considerations are important and the health considerations are very important. This was not discussed much when I was a student in architecture, and we're finding that there are a lot of toxins in construction today that we shouldn't be facing. I also think that the cost of construction is too high. We spend a great deal of time on that problem. Less than 5% of the people in this country can afford to build a house, and that's a dreadful situation.
Well, I think the cost of house building has been a real trauma to an awful lot of people.
That's quite
in the last 20 years.
That's exactly true. It's sad to see what young people especially are facing living in crowded conditions, having to rent, and I was faced with that for a very long time.
Well, I know you've brought along a plethora of interesting material here.
Yes.
How about let's looking at some of the low-cost solutions you've come up with?
Well, I'll start with my own house, which indeed is a structure that was built at a very reasonable price and uses some interesting structural systems. The roof system is a lamella, which uses 2x8s, 6 feet long. They are not very expensive in that length, so the cost of that was reduced. The cost of the foundations were reduced, and a lot of very reasonable materials used on the interior that were not so necessarily intended for those purposes. This is the lamella structure, as seen.
Let me see that.
Yes.
Maybe I can look at it and hold it for the camera at the same time.
Right. The lamella structure, you can see, develops a triangular relationship that's quite like the geodesic dome that Buckminster Fuller was so important in exposing to the world. But I'd like to trace the developments in this house back to one important development in La Jolla, where I live, where in 1894 the bungalows were built at the Cove Beach, the Red Rest and the Red Roost, as they were known, that in the first decades of the century made it possible for hundreds and hundreds of people to live at a reasonable price. You could build those houses for $200 to $300 a piece in the first decade of the century. So in a sense, they are progenitors of other low-cost housing in this country. I'm very much myself interested in an openable spheroid. Buckminster Fuller was, of course, devoting his time to the dome, a great deal of it. It occurred to me when I came to California that the openable spheroid might give us the sun and the light in an indoor situation, and at a 60-foot diameter, the garden can come inside of the home. So technology, in this sense, brings man closer to
what nature. What is this eyelid, I guess you might think of it as, made of?
There is a new material, a fabric, that has a 20-year guarantee. It's fireproof, it comes in colors, it's transparent or translucent. It's called Teflon. So then the space-age technology has helped us in this way.
Great.
If you think about it, the convertible automobile has been very successful in California, and indeed, convertible homes, I believe, would allow us to have our cake and eat it too. This shows the unisphere in a houseboat characteristic, and it does have several levels. I'm also very interested in ferrocement construction, ferrocement being a thin type of concrete that might build shell structures. And in 1980, I entered a competition in Hong Kong for a hotel that use the openable spheroid and ferrocement construction, developing a more biomorphic solution. Biomorphic relating to biology, architecture that is more inclined to be sculptural. This drawing here shows a building that is shell-like in nature, built out of ferrocement. Color can be inherent in it. And it's this kind of building that in this environment of the great American West, which is so rugged, allows a building to grace the site rather than be alien to the site. So many of the buildings we build are boxes, and there are no boxes in nature, that we at San Diego State are very much more interested in structures that are complex and more dynamic, softer. And this design here shows, in fact, a house in a dome that has some conoids. The conoids, we've discovered, have an energy structure that is very good for human habitation, somewhat like the spheroid. This biotronic energy, as it's known, is a fairly new discovery in architectural circles. But I think in the years ahead, as we approach the dawn of a new century, is going to provide much more significant construction. After all, it's only 100 years ago that the electric light bulb was turned on. And I believe that we here at this time are looking forward to other energy systems.
Well, now that looks very elegant and very expensive.
This was actually designed for a competition in Japan, and the theme was a house for healthy living. So the cost factor wasn't as significant. However, I can tell you that ferrocement construction done correctly should be half the cost of regular construction.
Of the regular 2x4
type construction. This shows another biomorphic type of design. As you can see, it's even more complex that I did in about 1963. That's more than 20 years ago. So I'm rather proud that it's something that I myself have been dedicated to for a long time. We're fortunate in San Diego that the sculptor Jim Hubble has built already some structures of this sort.
Yes, I've seen some of his work. Very exciting.
Definitely so. And I'm working on three structures we'll see later, one of them. And I believe this county and this area in the years ahead are going to be graced by much, much finer architecture.
Does this require some change in building codes or in...
Well, it's true that the ICBO, the International Council of Building Officials, has not yet officially tested ferrous cement, but that's a process that is not difficult to undergo. It's a matter of about $5,000 to $6,000 of cost. It's known that structures of ferrocement nature have been actually crushed underwater rocks in ships. They build ships in this technique. You've probably seen the shipyards here in San Diego using ferrocement.
Well, the Kaiser ships in World War II were made of concrete, weren't they?
That's true. This technique has been around since the last century, actually, ferrocement. It's nothing new. It just has not yet spread widely into housing. In about 1975, a house was built near Houston, Texas, using this technique. So it is gradually taking on.
Yes. How did you become interested in this exciting work?
Well, I realize that it's, to be frank, idiocy to build in such a rigid and narrow manner on such beautiful natural sites, that the earth is urging us to build something more graceful, softer, more complex. As Paolo Soleri, the great designer and theorist over in Arizona, suggested, we should be living closer to the land. He's working on a project of a megastructural nature which throws the automobile away, develops a cohesive vertical environment, a megastructure, so that 3,000 people can live in a coordinated fashion and not subjected to the abuse that the automobile provides in our spread out environment.
And you see the same kind of architectural idea being applied to the individual homeowner as well as to a complex like he is building.
That's quite true. It is very possible to build, for instance, in the earth. That's something I'm dedicated to. Earth sheltered housing, we call it. I'm working on three houses. Two of them are going to be earth sheltered. They will make it much better in terms of heating. We know that the spheroid is cheaper to heat and cool because there's less surface versus internal volume.
Also, the air would flow over the curved surface more easily than it does around corners.
That's quite true in aerodynamics. My own home uses that. As you can see from my house and a number of the other houses that I've built, show you a structure here that I built near Escondido in the past few years that is very rounded in nature. It is solar heated and it has three separate units actually. The parent suite on one end, the children's suite on the other end, and the family suite in the middle that allows the family to have their own areas for living and sleeping. The children actually have their own living room in their suite. And so this house provides really a kind of a compound situation, which in California there's a great history of. Outdoor living.
Yes.
That means the spaces between the units become outdoor rooms. Now, I did not invent that. Rudolf Schindler and other architects in the 30s and even in the 20s
were on that premise. Well, perhaps even back as far as the old haciendas had that kind of...
That's quite true.
You know, we have to take another break for a commercial.
Okay.
So as soon as we get done that, we'll come back to some more of these exciting buildings. We'll be right back. In our earlier conversation, we talked a little about another kind of, I suppose you could call it a building material, light.
That's right.
As a component of design.
That's correct. It was, I guess, in about 1967, when I was starting my graduate work at Tulane University, that it occurred to me that without light, we have no environments. And I spent a lot of time in New Orleans at Tulane University working on structures and environments built with light. I'll show you two of them that it was my fortune to build at that period. One of them was a jazz workshop for young musicians in an old building in the French Quarter of New Orleans. And it's largely built of paint and light. And the light is variable so that it can be adjusted to the sound of the music. A kind of a reaction then that makes architecture more sensitive to the environment, to what's being done in the environment. A second structure was a small apartment in the French Quarter that used light and color to expand the space both horizontally and vertically. Color and light are tremendous optical bits of material and information. In fact, we like to think of them as forms of energy. And it's through that discovery that I got into environmental energy in a larger context. When I came to California, I built an exhibition called the Electric Love Garden that portrayed lighted environments in a kind of a programmatic way and also provided the aesthetic side of the color light environment, which in an art department is very important. The Electric Love Garden dates about 1970. Since that time, I've done a lot of other structures and environments of that sort and teach a course called Synergetic Environments, in which we build environments with light. It's a fascinating...
That sounds exciting. What application does that have to homes?
Well, I can show you through the slides some environments of this sort, if we can look at those.
Well, they'll be up here on the monitor in just a second.
Now, this is my own home, and in La Jolla, it was, of course, built in about 1982. It is about 3,000 square feet, but I think we could go on to some of the other shots. Here we see it at night, which is very important.
Changes the entire perspective on it, doesn't
it? Exactly. We have a controlled environment in this case. The interior uses a lot of graphics, color. I do paint. This is my working studio. This is the other end. In fact, that large painting there is 8 feet in diameter. It was done during the days at Tulane when I was exploring color and light and led to the apartment and the jazz workshop. I do work with furniture design, but I think I'd go on to some of the other interiors. And well, this is the house for the Peruccis in Escondido, the solar heated house, three separate units. You can see the solar receptors on the south side.
And each of those units has a sculptural feel to it as it takes the light.
That's correct. As a matter of fact, those are solariums that you see. There are two solariums and a deck on the south side. The owner is of Italian heritage. He came to this country as a young man from Italy, and part of the ambience of the design relates to the Mediterranean. Mm-hmm. This is my own first home in Louisiana, and it did work with light in many different ways. It was built in a very low budget, too, I must suggest. The largest of the houses I built in Louisiana, this is about 3,000 square feet, two levels. They were all post and beam. The south side of that house, you can see the south side is pretty much open to the view to the river. Beautiful deciduous forest area. And the first home I ever designed as a professional architect, a client came to me my second day and as a registered architect, and I was very happy to have the opportunity to build this small structure, $10,000. There are a whole series, we can go through these fairly rapidly, of houses.
You can't build anything for $10,000 now.
This one was $25,000, and the most important, I think, from a theoretical standpoint, in that the living room is under a glass roof and is a greenhouse. This is a small addition to a doctor's clinic. Now, here in San Diego, it's been my fortune to build several structures using color and light. This picture is on India Street. I painted the graphics myself. The signage is more of an aesthetic type, and it did have outdoor dining, as you can see here, which is becoming quite common today in San Diego, I think very important to this community.
Yes.
This is a railroad car conversion into a hair cutting studio. Color and light, very important in this case. With the students, we've done a number of interiors at San Diego State. This is a cafeteria working with color and light. And a yardage shop in La Jolla, very important in terms of color. Now, this is probably the most important slide I can show you dealing with light, in that it's an invention that I came across in about 1967 of portraying environments like this. This is a French Quarter in New Orleans, in a graphic way before they're actually built. This is the apartment that I mentioned was expanded laterally and vertically by using color and light. And the jazz workshop in the same French Quarter. Here in San Diego, it's been my fortune to design a yogurt shop using light in a very important way. Robert Irwin, the sculptor, in fact, has a piece in the back of this shop which has four lights casting shadows on the wall. And the tables were lit up in a fiber optic manner. You can see them here. And the electric love garden, which is, as you can see, portrayed in a kind of wide-angle lens shot in New Orleans' small shop using a lot of color. My most important international competition is this one, the Iran Library, which is designed out of glass, structural glass, and designed to be a light environment at night where the cultural history of Iran is portrayed on the walls of the building by back projection on a screen that encloses. This is an art and architecture building for Southwest Louisiana University, a competition project. A house for San Diego using the same language of construction as my own home, the lamella system that I discussed. This is a shopping cultural center. You may have noticed that shopping centers today are more than simply places to shop, but many people go to shopping centers to see other people, to go to art and other exhibitions.
They're sort of the cathedrals of our time. This is that eyelid.
That's correct.
What did you call this?
The universal spheroid, or the unisphere, which mechanically opens up with two exterior skins. One's translucent, the other one's transparent.
Is that an affordable design?
It indeed is intended to be. This is a small scale version of that, 25 feet. I'm much interested in the house to be built for $20,000. $20,000 to $40,000 is what I believe we should be building at least smaller houses for.
But can that be done now?
With the technology that we have, ferro cement, even adobe, in this area we should be building with stone and adobe. We could, and this particular graphic, this is toward the end of the slides, shows a low-cost house. In fact, it's designed to be built for $40,000 in the center view. We'll see a larger image of that in a moment.
Yes.
Environmental structures. I think the two large drawings we have on the wall would be good to see, to discuss, in fact.
Right.
This business of biomorphics in one hand. This is a current design. I'm working on three sculptural concrete houses. You see Nir Hamul on a mountaintop. Ferro cement should be built at a cheaper price than even frame, and it allows a continuum of space that, as Lao Tzu once suggested, the reality of a glass is a space within. And there's no reason that we should be in boxes spatially. So this house will answer that need.
And the terrain itself is not
very rugged. That's correct. Very rugged. So the house is going to fit down into the site and relate to the natural site. The last image is the low-cost house that is quite a bit different from this. This house, much larger, as you can see, it has a great complexity. The low-cost house, in contrast, is quite simplified and somewhat of a mobile home nature. It's quite true today that many people can only afford mobile homes, but this is trying to take the mobile home into a much more beautiful caliber. In fact, I call this the sports house, and in a sense, like a sports car, an automobile that's openable, lighter, more buoyant in feeling, that has a grace and a spiritual quality that I think California has encouraged. I came to California for these reasons. There's a tremendous history of low-cost housing in this state, and I hope that we're contributing to it.
What do you see in the fairly immediate future with the high interest rates and high cost of housing? Are we going to see some of this kind of thing being
Very definitely. The last design I showed you relates to a concept we call the kit of parts. That means a homeowner could buy a package and assemble it themselves, be actively involved in the actual construction, and reduce the cost considerably. We're very much interested in a kit of parts approach that people have a choice to select and assemble their own home, either in a dome, a spheroid, or as a mobile type structure.
What an exciting prospect to be able to put up your own home and have it turn out to be as exciting and beautiful as these have been here.
We think so, Dr. Blume. I believe we have a great need for this kind of thing. The Red Rest and the Red Roost, built in 1894 at the Cove Beach, showed that a democratic society can have an economical house, but that was a long time ago. We need a new type today.
And I think the note you just sounded there, that in a democratic society, people need to have access to housing and clothing, food, and other things in an affordable way.
Exactly.
Or the whole meaning of our society is lost.
Very true.
Gee, it's been great having you on the show, and as we've talked before, I'm all excited about trying to build one of these myself.
Well, so, I hope we can help you. We do provide service to people with need. We have built a lot of things through the university with no charge. We'd be very happy to help you, and I'm very honored to be here today. Thank you so much.
Well, I'll be down with my site plan and talk to you about it more.
We'll be looking for that.
Thank you for being with us, and we hope the audience will come in again next week.
Thank you.
The Human Affair is a presentation of KUSI Television in association with United States International University.